Okay. Well, it's 2 minutes past, so we're going to jump in so we get as much time exploring the biosphere as possible. So, hello and welcome everyone to the inaugural Science Show and Tell that's put on by the North American Regional Representatives of the PAGES Early Career Network. We're really excited about this new speaker series as it will take a little bit of a different format than other more traditional webinars. So, we hope these events will give you both a bit of insight into the great work of early career PAGES members, as well as a taste of the variety of paleo research done in our community and what these lab spaces look like and what some of the methodology actually looks when it's being played out. So my name is Jessie Pearl. I am an early career network member working in North America, and I will be moderating today's event. So feel free to direct message me if you have any technical issues or any comments or questions. We are going to start today with a brief presentation from Dr. Dan Killam, who will then lead us on a virtual tour of his lab space. So please keep yourself muted if possible for the first part of the presentation and hold your questions until the end as well, because we are going to have ample time for questions and practical demonstrations after Dan gives us a little tour. So we also welcome you to utilize the chat function if you have any comments or questions for myself or for anyone else in the audience or for Dan. And after we give, Dan will give a little bit of an introduction. He'll show some slides, and then he will give us a virtual tour of Biosphere 2, which is his incredible working laboratory. And then we'll have about 15 or 20 minutes for interactive discussion and questions at the end, so Dan can actually show you what he's doing as he's doing it. So with that, it is my absolute pleasure to introduce Dr. Dan Killam. Dan received his Bachelor of Science in Environmental Studies from the University of Southern California, and he completed his PhD in paleobiology at UC Santa Cruz. So he went from environmental sciences to paleo sciences in his dissertation work. He was a Zuckerman postdoctoral fellow at the University of Haifa, studying the effects of climate change and potential tsunami events on bittersweet clams found on the Israeli coast. He is now a postdoctoral researcher at Biosphere 2 at the University of Arizona, where he grows giant clams to understand how they incorporate elements into their shells. So Dan has a blog called Clamsplaining, which I absolutely suggest you check out. It's great. And in his spare time, he cultivates carnivorous plants and has a pet hermit crab. So with that, I'd like to give Dan the floor and take us away on an adventure in Arizona.
Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in today. I'm sitting here on the beach of an indoor ocean at Biosphere 2. I'm under some tropical plants, and it's very tropically warm here. And so you might notice me sweat during the course of this talk because we turned off the fan so you can hear me. So you're going to get a real sense of what it's like to work in here over the course of this talk. So I'm going to attach in the chat. There's a video in my talk that I'll be sharing with y'all, but because Zoom is notorious for not doing well with video, if there's issues, feel free to open up this YouTube link that I'm putting in the chat that includes the video. So I've attached it in the chat. And with that, I will start sharing my screen and show you a few slides. We're going to have a few slides, then the video, and then I'm going to do a little direct show and tell with props because I'm trying to really lean into this format. So let's share my screen. Just a second. Can everybody see my screen okay? All right.
Yes.
Good, good. Let's go full screen. Just a moment. All right. So I am here in Biosphere 2, which is an enormous indoor ecosystem made up of several biomes. And we're in the middle of the Arizona desert in a place called Oracle, Arizona, just north of Tucson in the southern part of the state. And let me try to lead you into why. Oops, did we exit full screen mode for a sec? why we are interested in growing clams here. So Biosphere 2 is over 3 acres of indoor biomes, including a rainforest, a desert, a savanna, and of course, what I'm most interested in is the ocean tank. This place got its start in the late 80s, early 90s as a sealed ecosphere where there was no gas going in or out, sealed oxygen and carbon dioxide supply. And they were sealed in here for 2 years, from 1991 to 1993. But this is a facility is now owned by the University of Arizona and is a full-time earth science research institution. But in this picture from Google Earth, you could see huge domes made up of glass and all sorts of hardware that was needed to maintain that sealed ecosphere, because they were testing whether they could live in space and whether they could grow their own food and maintain their own oxygen supply, et cetera. So the Biosphere Ocean is a really special scientific environment in which to do scientific work. It's a 700,000 gallon saltwater tank. To put that into perspective, an Olympic swimming pool is usually around 660,000 gallons in volume. So this is the world's largest ocean mesocosm. It's a kind of encapsulation of broad, we use it to understand broader global trends, but in a controlled setting, approximating all of the various environmental effects that you'd notice in the real world. In recent years, they've been in a process of remediating the tank after a period when it was not maintained in tropical conditions. That involved removing overgrown algae, introducing new reef fish and all sorts of invertebrates, including hermit crabs, which I like to watch, urchins, and all sorts of fish as well, tropical fish. A heat exchanger was installed to bring year-round temperatures to 25 Celsius, 77 Fahrenheit. So it's pretty comfortable swimming in there, and which is a good thing for me, as you'll see later in the talk. And we have new initiatives going on. My advisor, Diane Thompson, is culturing corals to reintroduce on site. And there's an all new supplemental lighting rig in the works to really replicate the tropical light levels that would be experienced in the equatorial regions. Giant clams that we have in the ocean now are the first that were present since 1992. So it's a pretty big deal. And I'll be showing you some of those granddaddy clams that were here that were under the water for 30 years until I found them at the bottom recently. So what are giant clams? They're a subfamily of, subfamily of bivalves found on tropical coral reefs. They're dependent on reefs to survive. It's the only place they live. Their mantles, their tissue, are filled with a type of symbiotic algae, which is the same type as found in reef-building corals. The corals make the reefs, and the clams use the same strategy to also grow their shells really large, just like the corals grow their skeletons with the assistance of their symbiotic algae. The algae and the sugars provide the sugars that keep the clams well-fed and happy. By the time the clams are fully grown, they're getting the majority of their nutrition via the action of the algae. But they also conduct filter feeding like other bivalves do, taking in ambient plankton through their gills as a source of nutrition as well. It's a good arrangement between the algae and the clam, and because the host provides the algae with carbon, nitrogen, and a stable environment in which to live. Giant clams, as you might expect, can grow quite large indeed. There are some species like the Tridacna gigas, the true giant clam, that can grow over a meter in size and weigh hundreds of kilos. There are species that grow smaller, such as the so-called boring giant clam, so named because it bores into the reef and it's smaller in size. The ones we're growing here will eventually reach up to 2 feet in length. And so they'll get pretty large, not the true giant clam large, but large enough that they'd give you pause if you notice them on the bottom. So why am I studying giant clams? Well, I've started getting involved with research in giant clams during my PhD, wild ones in the Gulf of Eilat in the Northern Red Sea. We're interested in their biology because there are a member of coral reefs, which as you might be familiar, are under threat worldwide from climate change, over-harvesting, habitat destruction, and also pollution that can negatively impact the symbiosis that makes this whole thing work. There's a lot of research, including my advisor Diane and our team at Biosphere. A lot of people are researching how coral symbiosis is affected by these stressors. But giant clams, despite all of the overlap in their mode of life compared to corals, have comparatively much little investigation of how they're going to fare in the face of global change. And so that's kind of why I got started with them, because I figured there were a lot of lessons to be drawn in this comparative biology of these species. Mollusks and corals are separated by millions of years of evolution, and what's different about how they partner with algae between each other? So how exactly am I a paleontologist that I'm growing large clams why have I become a clam farmer if I'm a paleontologist? Well, in my work at the Red Sea, that work is currently in review, but we discovered that modern giant clams are growing faster in the present day compared to pre-industrial populations. How did we figure that out? We used growth lines in their shells. Much like the rings of a tree, we can investigate the rings in or bands or lines or whatever you want to call them in the shells of clams. And using those comparatively between modern clams and fossil examples, we can compare their growth through time. And there are suggestions in the geochemical data from their shells, in this case, nitrogen isotopes, that their symbiotic algae might be being fertilized by nitrate pollution introduced by humans in that Red Sea environment. But we need comparative measures of symbiotic health that are applicable to the fossil record if we're going to be able to say for sure that their symbionts were more or less active in the past. And so that's where the work at Biosphere comes in, because a lot of work has gone into understanding how the symbionts can affect their internal pH, the clams. All sorts of talented researchers in the Pacific, at the University of Singapore and other places have been tracking how clams' internal chemistry varies with the activity of the symbionts. And that internal chemistry should manifest in the trace metal content of their shell. But nobody has demonstrated this in a live sense while watching the clams grow and seeing what happens. We also want to measure their trophic level as measured by nitrogen isotopes. The issue with trying to do this kind of work in the wild is that these clams are protected. We would have difficulty obtaining the sample sizes we need and the experimental setup we need to verify that we can find the diary of the clams' symbiosis in their shells. We would have difficulty figuring that out if we were working with wild animals. But we're looking for a wild type environment where we can control the environmental signals so that we can tease out the internal biology of the clam in the record of the shell. And so that's where Biosphere is a perfect place to do this kind of work. Biosphere, we have a controlled temperature, we have controlled a pH. We don't have storms coming through, we don't have an eagle ray flying through and eating all the clams if I was to grow them in the wild. All of those are really big conveniences for me as a scientist trying to understand how the clams grow their shells and what their shells are recording. So we can observe live how the how the symbiosis of the clams manifests in their shells and also in their tissue chemistry, and apply those lessons to interpret our all sorts of wild-based clam records that the research community has put together over the decades. Giant clams are a pretty well-studied species in the context of paleoclimate, and I think it's a real treasure trove of potential information on how their biology has varied through time. That these clams have lived through past climate disruptions, and there's the potential to understand how their symbiosis responded to those disruptions in the past, and in order to learn lessons about their survival in the present. So here I'm going to start my video, and I hope it'll work, but if it does not, feel free to open that YouTube link I put in the chat, and and because I can never predict if Zoom's gonna behave on a certain day, but it'll be about 9 minutes. And so I won't talk during this 9 minutes. This was the best way I could kind of lead you on a tour around what I do while maintaining my connection to Wi-Fi. So with no further ado, I'll press play and hope it works.
Well, folks, I just plugged in my car next to the solar panels. And now I'm gonna head in and show you what a typical day at the office is like. Here's my office. It was one of the crew apartments for the original Biospherians. It's a lofted apartment, and they lived in here for 2 years in the early 90s in a sealed airspace. Nothing going in and out. So I don't know which crew member lived in here, but I now have my workspace. Of course, we're strewn with various cables and loggers, and this is where I plot up my data and drink my coffee and troubleshoot stuff and sometimes Zoom in here. But it's a very eccentric office space, but it serves me pretty well, fairly comfortable. Well, here we are at the education lab. This is where we would be leading school groups and stuff on tours if we were doing such things, but we're not. But I'm here because to show you my three favorite office mates. We got Floater, the Garibaldi. Link, the domino damselfish. It's kind of hard to see. And we have Dennis, the coral hawkfish. They're all three are very sassy, and they are surprisingly curious about me when I come in to heat up my coffee, but we got all sorts of cool specimens in here, including an example of Tridacna squamosa, the fluted giant clam. It's kind of an example of the goals I have for my guys about how big we hope to get them. So here we are at the ocean under the biosphere, the main biosphere space frame, which is consists of the metal frame with triangular glass panels between in a matrix. Here's under this tarp is where I have a lot of my computing equipment related to monitoring the light levels and the clams. I have it under the tarp because we get a lot of condensation dripping in here. Here's the lighting rig that keeps the clams alive. And the clams are actually under the water here. Can't really see them right now with the glare. But we have 12 clams down there of Tridacna dorsata, the smooth giant clam. And some of them have been growing since May. So I get in and snorkel every couple days to check them out, do various procedures with them. I'll describe it a little more what we're doing when I get to our lab space. But I spend a lot of time here on the beach working with the computer stuff and also getting in the water to check out the clams and how they're doing. I'll describe that more in my talk. So I unpacked the computing stuff from to show you guys, and we have a Raspberry Pi computer hooked up to our the monitor here, so I can program the Arduino, which is connected to the Raspberry Pi. Arduino is like a smart circuit board, basically a microcontroller that I use to connect to these cables and read the voltage coming back from those clam sensors. And then the Raspberry Pi is logging it. And You can see the live data rolling in here every second. And that data is telling us how open or closed the clams are based on the strength of the voltage coming back. Because we have a magnet, like this is a stack of the magnets I use attached to one side of the clam and a magnetic sensor on the other side. And that gives us the readout of whether the clam is open or closed. We also have under the lighting rig, we have a light sensor from Licor. A couple of data loggers measuring pH and dissolved oxygen through time, and as well as temperature. And on the other side of the ocean, we have a hanging sensor off of that boom, so we can kind of see spatially how those data points vary through the biosphere ocean. So it'll be interesting to compare those two time series, but here you can see the logger for the light is showing that we're above 318 micromoles of photons per meter squared per second, which is very good for the clams. That's a good amount of light for them, well within the range of what keeps the species happy. And so that means that I'm happy, knowing that they're gonna be, their symbiotic algae are content because the sun's shining bright and their lights are shining bright. And that means they're growing their shells happily, making their growth line for the day. Which means that, you know, happy clams means happy Dan. Here we are in an analytical lab, which is in one of the satellite buildings on the Biosphere campus. All sorts of cool work happening in here. They're conducting a long-term study of the weekly variability in the algae and plankton within the Biosphere ocean water. But for me, I'm typically just prepping my samples for geochemical analysis over at the University of Arizona campus. Here we have a couple of shells of the creatures we work with. This is Tridacna squamosa. This guy had met his demise when we had a power outage and he rolled himself down a hill and deprived himself of light, unfortunately. They can get themselves into trouble sometimes, these clams, but I was able to recover his shell. And you could see that he did not die in vain for the purposes of my experiment, because we see fresh shell growth. This white stuff at the edge of the shell margin is really the product we're interested in. It's the record of his life here in Biosphere 2's ocean water, and it's recording the ramp up of his symbiosis as they ramp up the degree of nutrition they get from the algae within their bodies as they develop. Here's an example of DeRosa that died during that power outage as well, a smooth giant clam. And you can see he as well has fresh white shell. It really is represents what we're interested in measuring as a diary of his own development. Well, now you got an idea of the typical life of a clam man here at Biosphere 2, I'm going to continue and answer all your questions and give you a little live demo from the ocean shore.
Okay. Let's exit screen sharing. Double check the my mic. Can you hear me still? Raise your hand if you can hear me. Good. All right. So I am going to be showing you some specimens. Here is one of the species we found that had been sitting under the water for almost 30 years since the original Biospherian exhibit. And we also have another one that was so poorly preserved, it started to fall apart. So it's kind of an example of taphonomy in a man-made environment. But this one was buried, and so I was able to find him, and we're hoping to do some work with him to figure out, because there are records of what the ocean was like in the original Biosphere exhibit, we're going to be cutting this guy open and seeing what he recorded. How long did he live down there? According to the information, it might not have been very long at all. They might not have had the lighting rigs set up, the lighting availability set up at the level needed for this species to thrive. So that's a question that we're interested in, and we won't really know until we open it up. It's kind of a surprise. But I was very entertained when I found it down there. Here's another of our guides that had grown a little more in the course of its experience, and it just kind of shows you how they keep a diary of their shell growth. This is when it lived in Palau, up to this line. This is up to this is when it lived in Florida, up to this line, and then everything since then up to around, I believe, yeah, this was in September. This guy passed away in that power outage that I mentioned. So we got over almost 2 centimeters of growth on his shell to work with in terms of new diary to read of this clam. So we got data already rolling in, and that makes me feel confident because the goals we have for these clams, some of them will be remaining as a permanent exhibit for people to enjoy. And they can reach, here, let me get the big guy to show you how big these can get. Here are my clam goals. This is Tridecna dorsata at nearly full size. I'm hoping to set up a clam cam so that people can see and appreciate these animals. Right now, all you can do is see them from the water. You can't see them through the glass. There's nobody going to the ocean right now because of COVID and the need to maintain distance, but we are gonna hopefully set up some ways that people can interact in the best way they can with these animals underwater. I have the clam data, as you saw, rolling in, so we can have a live readout of that. And I'm hoping to have some live footage of them, a webcam, once I figure out how to keep it waterproof and connected to Wi-Fi. That's a work in progress. I've also become a bit of a snail man in the course of this project. I didn't expect to, but there's all these little snails that live under the water at Biosphere that are actually a Californian species called the wavy turban snail. And they're California. It's weird that there's a Californian species living in this tropical environment, but that's because they used to be a lot more seasonally varying until they installed that heat exchanger to keep it warm all year. And so basically they went from, you know, seasonal swings in temperature like their native range to a more tropical year-round environment, kind of what their summer extremes would be like, but all year. And we're interested in how their growth responded to that change. And so because it kind of parallels what will happen with climate change as at the southern end of their range, they'll be experiencing these summer extreme temperatures more and more of the year. In the wild populations, it turns out that these guys usually die out during El Nino events and have a bloom in population. They reproduce and die out the larger individuals during El Nino events. So we're gonna be interested to find out what these shells record in their diaries. And I mentioned I was doing tissue sampling of the clams. It's not really tissue per se, it's more the fluid between, if you think of the clam's tissue and its shell outside, there's a pocket between where their flesh is and where their shell is. It's called the extrapaleal space. And that fluid in that space is essentially the building blocks of their shell. That's what they're using. They're pulling carbonate from that fluid and trace metals from that fluid in order to build their shells. And so we have been sampling with these flexible Teflon tip syringes. It's a non-invasive way that we can sample from the clam's internal fluids and understand what's going on in its body, but while allowing it to continue its life in an uninterrupted way. We've been testing that the last few months, seeing their response to it. And we're gonna be doing a time series of these extrapaleo fluid samples to compare to what the shell record says. So that's something that's been done with mussels and other clams, but never the giant clams. So it's kind of an exploratory thing. And then let's see, what other things? Yeah, just to show you, at the end of the experiment, like with those shells I just showed you that we got data from already, we'll be cutting them into cross-section. This is a wild clam from the Red Sea and dyeing them blue so that we can look under a microscope and see their microgrowth increments. There's a special dye called Mutvi solution that allows us to see these daily growth lines in the life of the clam. And each day represents, the increase of light during the daylight hours and then the shutdown of calcification in the nighttime hours. So those daily growth lines are one of the main reasons people have used giant clams so much for paleoclimate work, because it's a pretty crazy resolution and detailed age model to have to be able to interpret your chemical records. And so we're going to be interested in how fast our different individuals grew and how that relates to their symbiotic health. You might have seen in some of our pictures that we were using a color chart to track. We're tracking their color changes through time as well. And because you might have noticed the clams have a kind of a shiny iridescent look to them. That's the iridophores. They're called iridophores. And the clams use them to direct light towards the symbionts or reflect it when they're experiencing excessive light, because they're adapted for the shallowest tropical waters where they get an extreme amount of light availability. And so we're tracking how those iridophores vary through time as well, as kind of trying to relate it back to how their symbiotic health is. So that represents kind of a show and tell of what I'm up to. I just wanted, you know, to give you a run through of how a day in the life here at the biosphere is without drowning you with charts and other minutia. But with that, I will open it up to Q&A from all of y'all, because that's really what I'm here for, is to talk to all of you as a audience that knows a lot about the ocean and the environment and climate history. So thanks for listening, and hit me with all the questions you got and the comments and other observations.
Awesome, Dan, thank you so much. That was really wonderful. You're sitting and you're facing the water right now. Is that right?
Yeah. I'll take you back to look at what it looks like.
Wow.
There's my clams in the background. We have the umbrellas over them to keep the condensation off of the lights. But I often get in the water just from here and go check out the clams. And you might have noticed that I don't know if any of the footage had the urchins and the fishes. And I like to look at the anemones in here as well. And then I also like to walk around the general biosphere and appreciate the other biomes, because there's all sorts of cool work into tropical rainforest and other stuff going on here.
That's really incredible. So I think we have a manageable enough audience that if you have a question, I invite you to turn your video on, unmute yourself and ask Dan directly, or you can always put it into the chat. I have a lot of questions. I was super inspired by your work, especially the daily growth interval. I mean, as a dendrochronologist, I always tote the fact that I have annual resolution, and you've just totally swept that off the door. Daily resolution is incredible. So I invite anyone in the audience to unmute or share your video if you'd feel comfortable, and ask Dan some questions.
Hi, Dan.
Hey, Martin, how's it going?
Yeah, not too bad. I'm a bit jealous. You have it great there. I can understand that you don't want to come to Vienna. Okay, I'm interested in the water temperature you have. Is it day and night the same temperature? Is this are there any changes throughout the year?
It's a good question. We keep it at a 25 degree Celsius average, but there are slight fluctuations as indicated by the data. You know, there's a certain mixing rate in this across the tank. And so the heat exchangers in a certain spot. And so in night and day, there's small fluctuations around that mean, but it's a fairly small daily and seasonal fluctuation. There's far more air temperature variability. And so we have been tracking how the temperature varies in the lagoon in order to know whether there's any seasonal variability. It doesn't appear there's very much.
Mm-hmm. So the daily increments are due to the light?
Exactly. Yeah, it's almost entirely the light. Their symbionts directly assist in the creation of these, in their daily calcification. They are assisting with the proton pumping and in influencing the internal pH of the animal in a way that accelerates its shell growth during the day, and at night they're in a respiration mode mostly. And so those nighttime increments are the dark lines when it's slowing down, and the daytime increments are when it's growing quickly and bright white carbonate. Mm-hmm.
And if you had day and night water temperature differences that are bigger than those that you have now, how would that influence the increments?
So previous work with trying to have previous researchers have cultured these clams for like a few weeks at a time, or observed their growth in the wild, and found that most of the temperature variability on a daily basis was due to the light that they were recording. But they do have in the wild, they do have seasonal variability due to temperature. In the Northern Red Sea, it gets surprisingly chilly by tropical standards in the winter, and they will have a winter slowdown of growth due to temperature, but also partially due to the lower light availability in the winter. So the temperature will affect their growth to some extent. They have a certain thresholds that where they maintain growth comfortably up to like, I think it was 28 or 29 Celsius when they start to slow down at the upper end, and at the lower end, down to like 21 or 22 Celsius, they start to slow down also. So 25 was recommended as a nice middle range for maintaining the thermal health of these clams. That's what the reef keeping community uses. And so I'm really grateful for all of the people who keep these clams as pets in their reef tanks, because they provided a lot of background information to help me as a clam, you know, clam farmer, as it were, to try to keep these clams happy. You know, I was poring over books like a new dad trying to know what to do to keep them happy. So it's been a learning experience.
Okay, one last question. You have three species, or how many species do you cultivate?
So we started with three species. We had Tridacna maxima, the small giant clam, Tridacna squamosa, the fluted giant clam, and Tridacna durasa, the smooth giant clam. We didn't know which species were gonna thrive or not do well when we introduced them. While we got the light levels to the level needed for these clams to thrive, as suggested by their literature, we did not have much success with Tridacna maxima. They did not do well in the environment of Biosphere 2, possibly because of we think they weren't satisfied with the substrate we provided, perhaps, and also there are some fireworms in the tank that harass the clams from time to time, and that might have caused them some stress. It's something that we're going to experiment with other species in the future. We think a lot of it relates to the size of the abyssal opening. They have an opening at the bottom of their shell, and if that's wide open, that exposes them to stress and being attacked from below by various benthic, opportunistic species. But the durasas that we have are thriving the best, and we're looking into potentially getting the bear paw clam in the next, you know, yeah, that would be the biggest candidate for a future introduction would be, because it also has a lot of the same qualities as durasa. So yeah, it was kind of, it was truly an experiment, because the original giant clams, as I said, didn't do so well in here. And we didn't know which species would do the best in terms of the conditions here.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, good questions. Other questions?
Yeah, I would have one. Hi, Dan.
Yeah.
Very nice experiment.
Hey,
first to say.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, Martin already, I mean, the question of Martin already answered mine partly, but I was also wondering if there's if you know this already, if different species represent different kinds of shell archetypes, or if there's a different quality in the growth patterns, for example, or that one species might be more easy to read than another.
Exactly. Yeah, you're onto a good point there, and that was why I was glad we were able to get good records from the squamosas that grew, because they have a lower degree of symbiosis as measured by prior work has measured the direct photosynthetically active radiation being emitted by their tissue and found that squamosa depends more on filter feeding and less on the symbiosis comparatively to DeRosa. And they also grow slower than DeRosa is a really fast grower. That was one reason we emphasized DeRosa in our experiment, because we wanted the most record for, you know, the most bang for the buck in terms of shell being precipitated. But we do have that comparative approach of the squamosas that have slightly less dependence on their symbionts. They still need them for a large part of their nutrition, but less so. And so the comparative trace metals between squamosa and DeRosa will be of great interest in our results. And that's something that's been understudied in the literature because of the limitations that researchers have in collecting these species. They can't go and collect, you know, 20 something clams from a reef. They would have depopulated the reef of all the species that are present there in that area. So, but we have a luxury in dealing with a captive environment but still wild-like. The cross species comparisons is something that I investigated in my PhD a bit in terms of fossil clams and how their isotopic differences between species reflect back to their comparative niches along the reef. Mm. And so we will be definitely peering closely at the cross species comparisons going forward.
Yeah, sounds very nice.
Good question.
Do you know, I think at least in the past I saw there were quite a few attempts to breed, as you said, giant clams for the aquarium trade or maybe also for food, like in the Western Pacific area. Has there been any cooperation between such farms and scientists, at least to record, you know, like the best conditions for breeding different species or for like monitoring the growth in terms of estimating how to get most, I mean, the highest yield for the money invested?
Yes. I talked to quite a few people in the aquaculture trade in the course of knowing how to maintain the environment here, as does Katie Morgan, the head ocean technician here. We're always consulting with people in the aquaculture trade. We have our partner is in Florida, who we obtained these aquaculture clams from, and they obtained them from a operation in Palau that grows these clams at massive scale, like thousands of them at a time, both for food and for people to have as pets in their private aquariums. It's a major source of a sustainable and continuing economic output for Palau. I've been to that farm when I visited there as an undergraduate, and it was I didn't get to look at it in detail. We basically went by it. I was not a clam man at that point, or I would have spent a lot more time checking it out. But it's actually rather inspiring how well they hobbyists in the aquarium trade, how well they have grown to understand these animals. I consult the forums when I'm trying to understand an issue about my clams and whether they're happy. There's a researcher named James Fothery, who's a prolific blogger and wrote a book about rearing giant clams that I consult all the time in trying to know what I'm seeing, because the clams, you know, they occasionally get themselves into trouble, and it's really handy to be able to go back and check to know what I can do to make them happy again. I greatly depend on hobbyists and the aquarium industry in my work.
Okay, so the knowledge is there, but it has not been really a scientific approach, like kind of aquaculture science or like really for commercial purposes, you know, to really like to do it with fishery science when they monitor stocks and the like, and to develop the growth functions for different species to understand.
Yeah, it's 50-50. There are growth functions for giant clams. The US Department of Agriculture did a lot of work on them in the 80s in terms of trying to figure out the economics of their growth, what would be needed to grow these clams on an economically relevant basis, because they could be, if you think about it, they could be like, they're large animals and they're solar powered. So it's like making a steak without the middle, waste steps of obtaining food for them and it could be a truly sustainable source of protein, and it is for people in the tropics. Right now, the major limit for people eating these clams is that their flesh goes bad very quickly from oxidative processes that could kick in as soon as they're dead. So they're not commercialized on a global sense yet, but there are people working on that, trying to do the research to figure out how they could be more broadly commercialized. That is a work in progress, and it's been going on since the 80s. It sounds like it's a tough nut to crack. I'm glad it's not my project, but it's they've provided a lot of background information in their various treatises that were written. There was a real burst of it in the late 80s as far as research into how these clams grow across the population. And of late, it has really been a new renaissance of giant clam research in terms of what environmental preferences there are. There was recently a very big study on giant clam microenvironmental preferences all along the Red Sea. A researcher at Saudi Arabian Institute, KAUST, went all up and down the coast trying to figure out where do clams settle and why. And I was very interested to read that one. So, because that provides information on the preferred environment as well, and how that relates to their health. So it's still it's a field with a good pedigree that I've a lot of giants whose work I've built off of, but also a lot of exciting new work that I try to follow closely. I'm always excited when those Google Scholar alerts are rolling in.
Thanks a lot.
Of course, Jan. Other questions from folks?
I have one if no one else has one.
Sure, Jesse.
Islands. So I remember when I took a tour of Biosphere 2, they mentioned that one of the big issues they came across back in the early 90s when they did the experiment is that all their bees died because the windows were UV, the UV didn't penetrate the windows, and bees utilize UV for navigation. And so when we're talking about the importance of light and what that means for the clams, I was curious if that was an issue you're running into, or if they've replaced enough of the windows that that's not an issue. I'm not sure how much biosphere has changed since the 90s, but how much does UV make a play on clam growth?
Yeah, so it is. There were some pretty recent papers about how clams react to UV, and they do need it to some extent to thrive. Our lights are full spectrum. They include a full spectrum of visible light and a small portion of UV, to the extent that I actually have some of my color charts have faded over time. The light is so bright under these lights that we've arranged. But in the broader ocean, the UV levels are still quite low because the light blocks out almost all the UV and also part of the visible spectrum. That's why we're currently in the works of designing and installing broader supplemental lighting fixtures when corals are installed along the reef crest in the middle of the biosphere ocean. But for the purpose of the clam experiment, we obtained these lights from a company called Kessel that are full spectrum, and the technicians here, including Katie Morgan and Douglas Klein, is a really talented guy who's been here since the start of the biosphere, since the early days when they were pouring the concrete. And he designed this rather brilliant, mad science looking floating lighting rig we have going on here, so that over the clams, they would have the light levels they need in terms of photon and also the spectrum that they need. So far we've had pretty good success with them. The clams are growing. And we can see how they react. They react very closely to changes in light. For example, when we have storms, I'm always on the lookout for if they start to bolt. They will move to other locations using their foot to pull themselves along the base, the bottom of the water. But when they're content, they put down these things called Bissell threads that attach them. They root them in place. And so I'm always, when I'm going down to check on their health, checking for those signals that they're giving me about whether they're happy or not in the location they are in. I had to install a fence to keep these clams, a clam paddock, as it were, to keep them contained, because they kept rolling themselves down this hill next to their next to have where we have them set up. So I actually put a fence up, a chicken wire fence to keep them from rolling down to the base of the hill where there isn't enough light for them to do well. And that worked pretty well to keep them from getting into trouble during the darkest times of the winter. But you're right, the original biosphere experiment had all sorts of issues with unexpected consequences of the glass and how that affected plants and invertebrates and other creatures within this this environment. And so it's something that we have to keep in mind as we try to truly replicate what's happening in the broader world.
And then I have one just really basic question about clams, because I'm not very familiar. How long do these guys
live? Yeah, so the giant clams can actually live a fairly long time. The maximum threshold of how long they live is not truly well understood, but it's claimed by some researchers and supported by their growth lines and how they slow down through time, that they could live live at least 60 years and potentially as long as 100 years. Typically in the wild, the biggest limiter of their growth is they start to get overgrown by corals around them. But once they reach mature size, they do start to slow down a bit in their growth, but they can maintain their mode of life for extended decade-long periods. Other species of clams that are not photosymbiotic, like the Atlantic Arctic quahog, Arctica atlantica, it can live over 500 years. So bivalves are known to have extreme longevity among non-colonial animals. And so and giant clams are no exception, but they're actually unusually long-lived for a tropical bivalve, mm-hmm. potentially because once they reach a large size, they're just, pulling in the returns of their investment in tissue to pull in that solar energy to maintain their large size.
Thank you so much.
Of course.
I have a question, Dan.
Yeah,
kind of an esoteric one, but how much extrapaleo fluid can you extract from one clam?
Good question. It depends on how fast we get to him. When they start to close their shells, they're venting that fluid. And so we have to sneak up on them to get the maximum yield. And we can get a few milliliters of material from inside their shells. The clams are surprisingly small in terms of tissue. Within that shell. And so there's a surprisingly large extraspaleal space to draw fluid from. But it is kind of a delicate dance to get down there with scuba, having one of my colleagues help me while I'm down there to collect that material via the syringe. People have done that a few milliliter size from mussels in the past is one of the few studies to really sample from EPF. I don't know if Arctica, has anyone done that with Arctica atlantica?
They've tried.
They've tried
and it's not very successful. How do you get in there? Are you going in, you're sliding underneath the mantle, or are you piercing the mantle?
I am sliding underneath. There is a gap at the back of at the edge of the shell. Between where the siphonal mantle attaches and where the shell is, that if you go in from the side with that flexible syringe, you can get in there and sample from that pocket. It's not totally isolated from the environment, so I actually don't want to sample too much, or I start to sample from the ambient water. I basically go until the clam closes. They start to close as they feel me pulling, and at that point, the vacuum stops and then I pull it out.
Cool.
Yeah, there's a reason it's very difficult. It's been one of the more reach goals of my project. Because the clam does not want me in there. They don't feel it at first, that needle. But as soon as they feel water moving, they start to close up. So it's kind of you have to be quick. But I think it will be interesting to compare the makeup of that EPF to the makeup of the shell. Previous people with the mussels also use these Teflon-tipped syringes to get their samples. Other questions from anybody?
So it's a tourist attraction too, the whole biosphere?
Yes, you can come here right now. They have a very nice setup for a self-guided tour. They have an app that you download ahead of time, and you walk through watching videos about the things you see on a self-guided preset tour. They used to have group tours, but obviously with COVID, that needs to be paused for social distancing reasons. But I've actually been really impressed with how they've been able to maintain safety for the visitors and us staff in the terms of, you know, I'm not wearing a mask because I'm here alone on the beach, but normally I'm wearing a mask anytime I'm sharing an airspace with others. It's really been kind of inspiring, honestly, to see how they've been, they were so determined to make sure that people would be able to visit here in a safe way, because this place is really all about SciComm, is really a huge priority here. And so, visiting here and buying a ticket directly supports the research that goes on. So they put a lot of work into designing a thoughtfully designed safe tour.
And can you dive the ocean?
I don't know if visitors can, but I have dove here a couple times. We do have scuba gear on site, and I normally snorkel. I only dive when I'm needing to be down there with the clams for an extended time period in a very shallow water. Hard to maintain buoyancy in 3 feet of water when you're pulling a syringe, but I'm getting a little better at it with time. But yeah, they do have scuba work that goes on here, and we keep track of who on our team are divers, which is most of them, and there is always work going on. We have these big windows that people could go through to see. In normal times, there's an underwater viewing gallery that's open that involves cleaning the glass to make sure that everyone can see through to what's happening in the ocean. So it's a fully functioning dive facility here too. It's kind of like being in a big pool, a giant Olympic pool diving, but there's like urchins around you and fish that are annoyed at your presence, and clams. So it's a little different than a pool, but it kind of feels like a pool in terms of the water energy.
There are tides too, right?
Yes, there's a wave machine. So it's kind of like a wave pool. there's a wave machine that's always pushing water out, and it's kind of replicating how it would be in a lagoon environment for these clams.
Wonderful. So if there's any last questions, speak now or forever hold your questions to yourself. I don't hear any.
But if you have other questions, I will point out, I have a blog at dantheclamman.blog. There's a contact link on that blog where you can shoot me an email anytime if you have questions about what goes on at Biosphere, and or if you have cool stuff that you, I'm always like really eager to see people send me cool clam pictures of of what they've seen in their travels, and I collect that information. I'm really eager for that exchange. I learned from all of y'all about it kind of is like a snowballing clam snowball of clam information that I've tried to nurture. So keep it coming. Feel free to contact me anytime.
Awesome. Well, with that, we'd love to thank Dan and also Pages for supporting this webinar, seminar, show and tell. This was a really cool, unique format. I haven't been a part of a semi-live demonstration yet, and so I thought this was really wonderful. If you can put on your video and applaud with us, or there's emoji reactions as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you all for joining in to hear about clams. I hope you have a great day. Stay safe out there.
Thank you so much, right, and take care. See you.